If you thought trying to get your match on Tinder to reply was hard work, well, imagine being a plant that survived multiple extinction events, and now in order to reproduce, you've got to get your pollen shipped in from the US. Hey, I'm Vanessa Fuchs, and in today's episode of What the Flora, we're going to explore the fascinating world of cycad sex, and why sometimes scientists have to give this flora a bit of a helping hand to get freaky. While you're watching the show, you can leave your questions and comments, and we'll have one of our experts get back to you. Okay, I'm here with Dr. James Clarkson, who's a botanist and a cycad specialist at the Australian Institute of Botanical Science. And we're here at the Royal Botanic Garden, Sydney, and we're surrounded by some very special plants here in the Southern African garden. They're called cycads. I mean, you've probably seen them, but James is going to share some really interesting things about them. So, James, what are these plants exactly, and you know, what's interesting about them?
Well, cycads, when you look at them, they look like kind of a large or small squat palm tree, or even pineapple sometimes, but they produce these big pine cones, like the biggest cones you could ever see on a plant. And that's interesting. So that groups them with plants like conifers. And so these plants are what we call seed plants and produce physical seeds. And they date back around 250 million years. But what we have around us today are probably only evolved in the last 10 to 12 million years, not very long ago.
Not very long, no. I can't even get a grasp of that concept of time. But hang on, you're saying these were around, or their ancestors were around in, you know, the time of the dinosaurs?
Absolutely, yeah. So cycads during the Jurassic and the Cretaceous period would have been the main plant or the main thing. So things like your triceratops would have tried to eat cycads. So this spikiness that cycads have comes about from that, to protect themselves from being eaten. Because you can imagine a cow now, a triceratops is a very big cow.
Super technical. No, that's awesome. But yeah, you have mentioned as we were setting up here, you know, not to get too close to them, don't touch them. Even a smell is wafting through that, you know, could be dangerous. Can you touch a little bit more on, you know, that side of things?
Yeah, so all parts of a cycad are toxic. They are, and you don't want to eat cycads. If you did touch them, you get spiked by them, it'll itch a little bit, it'll make you bleed. It's not the end of the world. The pollen can be pretty bad for you and bad for your respiratory system. But small doses of it, it's okay. But these plants in the collection are here to remain, and they are spiky, but they're incredibly architectural.
They're beautiful, and you know, that's what botanic gardens are for. They're a wonderful place to spend your time, and they're amazing plants that have been able to grow here. But is there more of a point to having them here? What is it, you know, what's the bigger picture?
Well, cycads, out of any organism on the planet, are the highest group of extinction. So more than 62% of cycads are endangered in the wild with extinction. And so having the plants here, it's a conservation collection, but not only that, it's got a major, amazing educational value, because these plants have so many characteristics that link them to times gone by, or what would have been round at the time of things like dinosaurs.
Yeah, that's cool. And I mean, to make more of them and look after them, I mean, there's a bit of reproduction stuff involved. And we're going to be looking at a plant here that needs a bit of a helping hand, a cycad. What makes them interesting from that side of things, their reproduction?
Well, so we used to think cycads were wind pollinated, but we now know they're not. Probably wind accounts are probably 2 to 3% of pollination events. So cycads are generally pollinated by little beetles, thrips, or the little native stingless bees that we have in Australia. And these are the pollination sources for these plants. And that's pretty interesting.
Okay, so we're gonna go set up for a pollination demonstration. That rhymes. So let's go over there. We're gonna meet Scott, and he's gonna help us out with pollinating a cycad. All right, we're here in front of a cycad, and James is going to tell us a little bit more about this plant in a sec. And Scott has also joined us. He's a cycad specialist horticulturist, and they're going to take us through a pollination demonstration for this cycad here. I'm pretty excited. But first, what species is this cycad? Can you tell us more about it, James?
Well, this, Vanessa, this is Encephalatus lemanii, also known as the Karoo cycad. And this occurs in the succulent Karoo, dry areas of Southern Africa. And you can see the leaves are quite slightly blue in color. Yeah. And this is like a natural built-in sun protection. So it's from a really dry, arid area. And this is what's really quite cool about this cycad. And these are endangered in the wild. So actually pollinating this and getting some seeds from it, really good for our living collections to propagate these plants.
And so we're going to pollinate it today. Well, you are, I'm not doing it. Why can't we just, you know, use pollen from something we found in the garden? I mean, is there another one of these or is it the only one?
Well, we actually have a few more plants of these, but shamefully the male plants, if we have male plants, they haven't produced cones this year. So we've actually had to get pollen from elsewhere. We've ordered pollen from both San Francisco and within Australia.
Wow. All right, so you've been talking about this cycad being ready for pollination for like a month now. We've been waiting eagerly. How can you tell that it's ready?
Well, we can tell that it's receptive, is when at the top of the plant itself, I do this without getting spiked, these little cone scales just here, which we call sporophylls, start to become more loose. So, of course, wind can't get into this to pollinate them. So it indicates these really are not wind pollinated. Because a long time ago, we used to think cycads were wind pollinated. But we now know it's little beetles, and these little beetles get around the cone, and they basically are covered in pollen, because the beetles spend all the time in the male cone. And what the male cone does at one point in the day, it starts to heat up. And it produces a toxic chemical, and this chemical pushes the beetles away. And the only safe place for this beetle is the female cone at the time. And they kind of swarm inside this female cone, go out, and then inside there's all this pollen. And the female, that each individual ovule or seed, which is a little droplet that collects any pollen in the vicinity and brings it in.
Wow, that's cool. But that can't happen for this plant, so you guys have got to help it out.
That's right.
So I'll just let you lead us through this whole process now of what's involved in making this happen.
Yeah, so this is a real different process with this plant. Some cycads, the cone opens up quite a bit, and so it makes it quite clear to kind of pollinate it by either using a water system or by using dry. So we're using a dry pollen system just here. So the pollen's in here for this plant. I'm going to use a little bit of a blower. But to get this blower in there, there's not enough space. So we actually have to drill a hole into this cone. So we draw four holes, two at the bottom and then two at the top. I'm just going to use a standard drill. Scott's going to do this. But what we always do is we use ethanol. So ethanol is to clean the drill bit to make sure we're not going to pass on any infections to the plant itself. And that's really important with any plants in our living collection. Do the honors, Scott.
Okay.
Does this hurt the plant?
Well, it's not going to like it.
Yeah.
We're now going to put on the masks because the pollen on cycads, all parts of cycads are toxic. And so, of course, when we're blowing pollen into them, we have to make sure that we're doing this right.
So what are you doing? You're basically
So I'm shoving this up the hole, you see, that we've made. And now I'm going to basically give it a really good squeeze to kind of...
Wow. How many holes do you need to...
We're probably going to make about four on this cone.
Okay. And again, that's best practice or...
Well, I think this is good practice in this case. So the bottom of the cone, normally these lower cone scales, are normally, they're not sexual anyway. Some of the cones will actually have seeds in them.
Yeah.
You see, so they're sexually active and they have the ovules. But a lot of the ones at the lower are just infertile.
Okay.
And they're just structures to kind of hold shape and
sure.
things. That's it, Scott. Yep. Okay, go for it.
Round two. So how are you able to obtain this pollen? I mean, who do you email? You know, how do you go about that whole process?
Well, that's a good question, actually. Well, what we have is we have a whole system. The international, so Botanic Gardens International have a separate subunit called the GCC, which is the Global Consortium of Cycad Conservation. And we have an email list we contact there that does a call out for all Botanic Gardens over the world to see if they've got this pollen.
that are part of the consortium, and we get it through there.
Great. So you said San Francisco and where else?
And in Australia as well.
Great. Yeah. That's the whole process for pollinating.
That's
how
right.
do you know if it worked? You know, how much time?
So in about 120 days, the pollen will germinate inside the seed and produce little sperm cells. And these little sperm cells will compete to fertilize the ovule. Only cycads and ginkgo in plants that produce seeds do this. And in about another 12 months, we'll probably get the cone will break apart and produce viable seeds.
Awesome. I hope you enjoyed today's episode of What the Flora. If you've got a question about cycads or something else you saw in today's episode, then just leave a question in the comments section and we'll have one of our experts get back to you. Make sure you are following the Royal Botanic Gardens Sydney on YouTube and social media to keep up to date with the latest episodes, because we've got another great one planned for next month.